Light.
Could you?
Are we starting recording?
Yeah.
Are you recording?
Yes, I'm recording, but do you want me to see the clapperboard? I haven't done that.
I can do that. Look, I'll get involved. Hold on. Memories of a Free Festival, part one.
Everything was fun. Throwing Marilyn. What was upset? Throwing Boy George Steve straight. Ah.
Smelly, dirty, racist, right-wing, awful place.
When I used to walk along Oxford Street, dressed up as the first incarnation of Marilyn, in a cocktail dress, and I was literally stop Oxford Street, and people like leaning out of cars screaming, ah!
I was a teenager in the 70s, and, you know, sort of piles of rubbish, burning cars are exciting. To start with, punk was all about the clothes and all about kind of, it was a sort of finger through civilized, you know, society. But, you know, it was a fashion thing, absolutely. No question about that.
Our crowd as well, he was gay, I was straight. It didn't really matter. We were applauded for being ourselves. Nobody was conforming, ever.
I was very pretty. Everyone used to say, what's your daughter's name? That was it. I was always called a girl. Everywhere I went, other kids called me a girl. From about 6 or 7, I had kind of long hair. You know, I was sort of a bit like David Cassidy, you know, that kind of flicked sort of hair. I was drawn to bright things. So if Mum wanted to buy me like a brown jumper, I wanted the one that was orange with a palm tree. You know, I used to get into a lot of arguments. And I was, like, pretty sensitive, outspoken. I was, you know, always called names from as long as I can remember, long before I really even knew what they meant. You know, if there was a gay person on telly, I'd get called that person the next day, Larry Grayson, whatever it was.
Well, I'm cock-a-hoo.
I mean, I'm not a screamer, but I knew I wasn't like other boys from a very early age.
Everyone was doing it and everyone else. It was like a petri dish. It was horrific. Except me, I didn't do any of those people. I don't want to catch anything.
Everybody was friends.
You know, first of all, let's just talk about how sometimes difficult it was to get in, especially if you were a rival. And I was a rival of Steve's at that point. We weren't really always on the best terms. So there would be periods where I'd be his best friend, then he'd kind of get rid of me and replace me with someone else. So I was always at war with Steve. There was this kind of terrible fear that I'd get there and I wouldn't get in. And I think there were one or two times when he tried not to let me in, but unfortunately, I knew so many people that just got on his fucking case that he just had to let me in. He was going to beat me up once in the tube station. That was hilarious, where he was dressed as sort of like, he was wearing this sort of Captain Biggles look. You know, it was kind of cool. He used to have some great looks, Rusty. And Rusty was quite hot when he was younger as well. I mean, he was kind of gorgeous. He had the slicked hair and everything. And we kept calling him Captain Biggles, and we were just torturing him and torturing him. In the end, he went for me on the Tuesday. He denies it to this day. He's like, I never did that. I'm like, oh, yeah. But we did push him. Me and Marilyn just literally kept pecking away like a pair of nasty crows.
I mean, Marilyn, who is absolutely gorgeous, through us all. And if you asked Marilyn what his real name was, he'd say, Norma Jean.
And Marilyn was really young then. I think he was like 16, 17, even when we were living in the squat. So for him to be dressing up full time as Marilyn then, when you just didn't see people like that walking in the streets, I mean, gender, you know, the gender bender or whatever they called it, but gender fluid, you just didn't see people like that, and especially that young.
The genesis of it, because I was really, really bullied at school. I mean, like the whole school, I used to be frightened to go out into the playground and stuff. So I had to kind of like, it was build up this internal, like, and I grew my hair really long on one side, so it was, so I was hiding behind the hair and walking along the corridors of the school, and I used to wear drain pipes. This is when everyone wore flares, and I'd put all safety pins down my, and the more they did it, it made me go, you're calling me a name, look at you. I used to go in to do art classes, and the teacher would say, like a still life, like a vase and an apple. I'd draw Marilyn Monroe. And they'd say, draw the Tower Bridge, and I'd draw Marilyn Monroe. Whatever they asked me, I would always draw Marilyn Monroe. So I was coming out of art class one day, and then going, oh, Marilyn, it's Marilyn. I'm thinking, oh, God, here we go. And I thought, you know what, I'm going to keep that name. And in the future, you'll be reading that name, and you'll still be in this school, probably cleaning it. And I love Marilyn Monroe. I am Marilyn. I'm still Marilyn.
Very quickly, you realised that to be a Blitz kid, to be part of that crowd, had to be a full-time profession. So it kind of was like you knew this was a fork in your life. Am I committed to this? Am I prepared to take the stick that you're going to get back on the council estate where you live? Am I prepared to take the ribbing from my brothers? Am I prepared to worry my mother sick? Am I prepared to almost say, this is my future? Because I'm committed.
You have to remember, it's like, when something starts getting publicity and stuff, you start getting the people from the suburbs that come in and they put on their mum's clothing, like, or, you know, grandma's eyeliner, and they came in like, oh, aren't I weird? Ooh. I thought they were a bunch of posers. Do you know what I mean? It's like, not some of them, like the people that I knew, were like great. All the people in Warren Street, and we lived it. I mean, like me and a few certain other individuals, I used to get totally done up to walk to the end of the street to buy milk. You know what I mean? Authentic. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't put it on a Thursday night to go to Blitz so Steve would let me in. Do you know what I mean? We lived it. It wasn't an assumed. It was like, it wasn't fancy dress. It's like it felt like people there were in fancy dress.
George was the coat check girl, right? And I'm not gonna, you know, tell too many tales about George, but you didn't leave too much in your pockets.
George was funny. I mean, I think that's why I liked him so much, because he had a really wicked sense of humour. He was bold, he was unapologetic, he didn't care. Like I said, George walked around like he owned everything.
George was always, he's a really fast talker, really smart, very funny, very quick-witted. I remember once he and I were doing, we modelled at the Sir Martin's fashion show for Stephen Linnard. And afterwards, George and I stole all the dressing-up clothes out of the dressing-up box. We ran back to his squat and we were going through them. And he'd got a pile and I'd got a pile. And I went, oh, that matches the skirt I've got here. He went, it'll cost you. He was trying to charge me money for something that we had just stolen. That was quite funny.
George was always getting caught nicking, so I was always bailing her out. She was a kleptomaniac, so I had to keep an eye out for her, because they'd come around and kick the door in. These are other people in the squats, like friends, like they wanted to come, you know, like villagers with pitchforks. They would come around like periodically to come and get all their stuff back that George nicked.
Well, there was a lot of stealing. I was a big thief. So I used to steal money from everyone. And when I worked in the Blitz, I got fired because I went through with people's handbags and pockets and helped myself up, topped up my wages, because they weren't very, wasn't very much. So yeah, I was, you know, and then finally I got my job back at another club, and then I got fired again. So this particular night, I don't know why they let me back in, but they did, because I was happening. I got back in this club, and because someone else had taken my coat room job, I nicked the money. I got under the counter and I nicked it, and I ran back to my squat and I folded it up in a bag and I put it into the toilet system. And then Steve Strange and all these people, Rusty, all of them, they all turned up at my squat and they were like, we know you stole the money. And I was like, as if I would ever do that, I totally fronted it. I was like, you can't accuse me of doing that. I totally fronted it, I lied. And then I think I ended up about it eventually. But yeah, I was terrible. I was like Jack, I was like Oliver Twist. I was always stealing things. You had to steal. Oh, the music was so pivotal. The music was kind of more important than anything, as far as I was concerned. It was a place you went to hear new things. So, like, you know, if you were in a club and you heard a record that you'd never heard before and you were like, this is amazing, what's this? And you'd have to sidle up to Rusty and hope that he was in a good enough mood to let you know, because everyone was really protective of where they got things. And Rusty played everything from punk stuff to, you know, things from cabaret, you know, and that influenced what I did. I became a DJ around the same time. And I used to play a lot of the things that Rusty played, and I'd be more bonkers sometimes and play things like The Lonely Goat Herd from The Sound of Music to try and get rid of people, but they'd always stay.
I'm not trying to insult anybody, but the fact is, I hated the music. Sorry, Rusty, I don't want to insult Rusty and then talk about music. Oh my God, I've lost it. but I don't mean it like that. It's like he loved it and he's passionate about all of that. And you know, it's got its audience. I'm just not one of that. It's not my flavour. You know, I like soul and gospel and the Blitz wasn't that. It was like all that electronic crap, like German electronic. She's a model and she's looking. Like, go away, I don't know you. Really? Like, is it that bad? You know, it's like I thought they were tragic.
You had Studio 54 in New York that had happened, you know, before. And I think that what Rusty and Steve were trying to do was create something similar in London for people that they felt were like-minded. You know, we were all Bowie kids. That was the thing we all had in common. We all were Bowie fans. The night Bowie came to the Blitz, everybody lost their cool. Like, the coolest people were the uncoolest people. I was the only one who was able to keep my nerve.
George flew! Literally, I mean, the man had wings to get to the front door, right, to see Bowie. Because Bowie was the basis of all of this. We'd seen Bowie, age 13, on Top of the Pops. We'd been there when Bowie had played live. The original Billy's Night was a Bowie night, and now...
There was always, like, competition for the way you looked. You know, sometimes Steve would turn up at my squat, you know, uninvited, literally just to show me what he was wearing. I remember this one time, I hadn't spoken to him for months, and then he turned up at my squat and he had these black contact lenses in. They were the whole of his eyes. It was amazing. I was so jealous. I was so jealous. And he only came to piss me off. He came in a cab, got out of the cab and was like, do you want to go for a drink? And I was like, you son of a bitch, look at you. He was done, like, amazing with a cane and these black eyes. Yo, and then, you know, you'd have to kind of plan the next thing you were going to do to piss him off. You know, it was absolute constant competition. When you...
No one was competition for me, darling. Like, let's have it, you know, let's have it straight. Who's gonna compete with me at all, ugly?
And then one week, Mick Jagger arrives. And of course, Mick Jagger's Mick Jagger. You know, this is probably the most famous rock star in the world. And he arrives, and word went out, Jagger's outside. Mick Jagger's outside. And Steve was magnificent. Mick Jagger, you know, obviously walks to the head of the queue, and there's a queue of people drooling, both because Mick Jagger's there and because they think they might get in. And they didn't. And nor did he. It was the greatest move Steve ever made. Mick Jagger walks up. Steve Strange, who's what, 20, 21, kind of boy from Wales, dressed in a dress, looks at Mick Jagger and goes, nah, you're not well-dressed enough. Literally.
Mick Jagger? You don't turn away Mick Jagger. I remember thinking, like, Steve, like, really? You can't turn away Mick Jagger from the Blitz, but it was so great publicity. He was great at that. He was really good at sort of just, like, doing stuff that was quite punk rock doing that.
somebody said to me, oh.
I don't know if there was any deep political kind of undercurrent except the sort of resistance of the norm, which I think in a way is political. You know, sometimes being yourself is the most political act you can ever commit. And it's like saying, no, this is what I am, and unapologetically, I'm queer, and I'm not depressed about it. You know, I think we were the first people of our generation to actually not wish we were straight.
It didn't matter.
We just wanted to be ourselves.
You know, you've got to remember where we came from. It was, everything you do is a reaction to the sort of cultural experience that you grow up with, you know, to the masks that you're forced to wear, you know, when you're a kid. You know, and especially if you're a kid like me or Steve or anyone, where you're, you know from very early on that you're different, right? You know, everyone else knows it before you do. They're like, you're not like us, you're weird. You don't like football. What's wrong with you? And, you know, you're developing in this weird vacuum, you know, and nobody wants to talk about what it is you are. And then suddenly, you know, you walk into the Blitz and you go, oh my God, you know, who knew? There were so many others.
In just a-
we were influencing each other.
Do you really want to hurt me? Do you really want to make me cool?
We knew that we didn't fit in. We knew that we were different. We knew that we wanted different things. We didn't want 9-to-5 jobs.
On a Tuesday night, no one over the age of 21 at that point go on to shape the next decade.
Were the forerunners of a man's right to be pretty. You know, look at guys now. Go on Instagram, everyone's in their underpants. Like, just basically, like, loving themselves in a way that was not permissible when I was a teenager.